जय हिंद एवरीवन, माय सेल्फ डॉक्टर वन्ना शर्मा फ्रॉम अजय कुमार गर्ग इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेज. माय सब्जेक्ट विच आई एम टीचिंग दैट इज इंजीनियरिंग फिजिक्स एंड द सब्जेक्ट कोड इज KS101T. द टॉपिक विच आई हैव स्टार्टेड इन माय लास्ट लेक्चर, दैट टॉपिक इज इलेक्ट्रोमैग्नेटिक फील्ड थ्योरी. सो इलेक्ट्रोमैग्नेटिक फील्ड थ्योरी और इन अदर वर्ड्स इलेक्ट्रोमैग्नेटिक्स, वेन एवर आई एम सेइंग इलेक्ट्रोमैग्नेटिक्स, it means we are dealing with a combination of electrostatics and magnetostatics. So as I mentioned in my last lecture, that electrostatics means we are dealing with the charges which are at rest, means we are dealing with electric field. And when I'm saying magnetostatics, then we are dealing with the charges which are moving, or we can say we are dealing with magnetic field. So electrostatics, dealing with static charges or charges at rest. Magnetostatics, that is dealing with the charges which are moving. Whereas this electromagnetics, which is the combination of both the fields, that deals with both type of charges, charges which are at rest as well as charges which are moving. So this particular branch, electromagnetics, is the combination of electrostatics and magnetostatics. So as I mentioned here, that in electromagnetics, the basic, or you can say the heart of electromagnetics, is four equations, and those equations are your Maxwell equations. Now the question arises that why this particular branch electromagnetics is required? What is the application of this particular branch? So the very simple answer is that whenever we are using our smart devices, whenever we are using internet for communication or for information, then we are using a particular part of electromagnetic spectrum. Means for the communication, we are using electromagnetic radiations. And the electromagnetic radiations, when they are propagating in a certain medium, then how they are propagating, what type of energy they are carrying with them, all these questions, they will be answered with the help of electromagnetics. So electromagnetic field theory or electromagnetics is a very important branch in order to deal with the communication with the help of electromagnetic radiations. And if you want to understand that how the energy is carried by electromagnetic pulse when it is propagating in a certain medium, then you can easily understand with the help of those Maxwell equations or this electromagnetic field theory. So the answer of all these questions, that is in this particular topic. Now in this electromagnetic field theory, we are going to cover different topics. So I have mentioned all those topics in my previous lecture, and the topic which I have already covered, that is continuity equation. Sorry, give me 1 minute. The topic which I have already covered, that topic is continuity equation. So we have already discussed this continuity equation. But before the continuity equation, I have given you some mathematical operators which are the basic ingredient of electromagnetics. So I have told you about a vector differential operator which is denoted by del. Then I have I have explained about gradient, divergence and curl. Gradient, that is only the product of this vector differential operator with the scalar. Divergence, when you are taking dot product of this vector differential operator with another vector. And curl means when you are taking the cross product of this vector differential operator with another vector. So you are having those three operators. One is gradient, second one is divergence, and the third one is curl. And all these operators, when I am saying 1 plus 1, means you are adding 1 into 1. So that plus sign, that is a mathematical operator, and it is having significance that you are adding two terms. So similarly, each and every mathematical operator, it is having its own significance. Like when I'm saying that we are taking curl of a vector, then curl of a vector, that represents the rotational behavior of that particular field over which you are applying that curl or that operator. So each and every mathematical operator is having its own significance. So all these operators are significant. I have told you about two important theorems. We haven't proved those theorems. I have just given you the statement of those theorem. And those two theorems, one is converting surface integral into volume integral, or you can say volume integral into surface integral. That is your Gauss divergence theorem, and the other one, which is your Stokes theorem, that can convert a line integral into surface integral or a surface integral into line integral. So we have discussed about all those two theorems there. Then we have derived this continuity equation. So basically this continuity equation, that is our law of conservation of charge. So whenever you are applying an electric field over a conductor, then current will start flowing in that conductor, and that current will be in a direction opposite to the flow of electrons. So that equation I is equal to minus dq upon dt, when you are writing this simple equation in differential form, then that is your continuity equation that represents your law of conservation of charge. We have already derived that law of conservation of charge in our previous lecture. Now the topic of today's discussion is this one, that is your displacement current, right? And with the help of this concept of displacement current, we will try to prove that there is a need of modification in Ampere's law. So this is the topic for discussion for today's lecture. So I'm going to discuss this lecture to this displacement current today. So displacement current. In electromagnetism, displacement current is a quantity appearing in Maxwell equations that is defined in terms of rate of change of electric displacement field. Now, what is the meaning of this? I am going to explain it now. Displacement current has the units of electric current and it has an associated magnetic field just as actual current do. So, whenever I am saying current, then in general form, current means the electrons, they are moving in a certain direction in the presence of external electric field. And when they are having a directed movement, then because of that directed movement, there is current in that conductor. But this directed movement of electrons, which is giving us a current, that current is known as your conduction current. So whenever there is movement of electrons, movement of charge carriers in a certain direction, then because of that movement, we are having our ordinary conduction current, which is there in the wires available in our homes or in our offices. But there is one more type of current, which is known as displacement current. Now the beauty of this displacement current is that just like ordinary or conduction current, it can give us a magnetic field. You know that if you have a conductor and if current is flowing in that conductor, then around that conductor you will get a magnetic field. Similar to that, this displacement current, just like conduction current, it can give us a magnetic field. So that is the property of displacement current, which is similar to conduction current. But the origin of this displacement current is different as compared to conduction current. You know what is the reason or what is the cause or what is the root of that conduction current? Root is that in a conductor you have electrons, but they are having random movement. So there is no net flow of charge or no net current in that conductor. But whenever you will apply a potential difference, an electric field, there will be a directed movement of electrons and you are going to get that conduction current. So that is the reason of conduction current or ordinary ordinary current in a conductor. Now the question arises that what is this displacement current and why it is different than our ordinary conduction current. So I will try to explain this concept with the help of a simple parallel plate capacitor. So I am going to take a simple parallel plate capacitor and then we will try to understand that what is the reason of this current. And with the help of this concept of displacement current, how the Ampere's law that will get modified, right? So you have this conductor, this is a current carrying conductor. In this conductor, current I is flowing, right? And you know that according to Ampere's law, first point is, if you have a current carrying conductor, then around that current carrying conductor, you are going to get a magnetic field. So, what will be that magnetic field? in terms of current that is given by Ampere's law. So you are having this current carrying conductor. We are taking a closed loop here, right? So according to Ampere's law, this closed line integral of magnetic field, that will be equal to mu naught times the current enclosed by that closed loop. So if I is the current enclosed, then this Ampere's law states that a closed line integral of magnetic field is mu naught times the current enclosed. So what is mentioned over here? Imagine a wire connected to a charging or discharging capacitor. The area in the Ampere's loop could be stretched into the open region of capacitor. In this case, there would be current passing through the loop, but not through the area bounded by the loop. Now, what is the meaning of this? I'm going to explain in the next slide. So, if you are having a current carrying conductor, then around that current carrying conductor, there will be a magnetic field, which can be explained, or you can write the expression for that with the help of Ampere's law. And you know, this is the famous Ampere's law. The closed line integral of magnetic field is mu naught times the current enclosed. So now what we are doing here, we are choosing two closed loops, right? We are taking this closed loop, this first loop is here, right? And the second loop that is taken just in between the two plates of this parallel plate capacitor. What you have here? You have a parallel plate capacitor. These are the two plates of that parallel plate capacitor. You can understand it like this. This is a parallel plate capacitor and it is connected to a battery, right? And there is a key K. Right, with the help of this key K, you can control this circuit. You can open the circuit, you can close the circuit. Now two closed loops are taken. The first loop, this is C1, and the second similar type of loop that is chosen between the two plates of parallel plate capacitor. So again I'm explaining, these are the two plates of parallel plate capacitor. These are the plates. This is first plate P1 and this is second plate P2. Now this particular parallel plate capacitor that is connected to a battery, and this is key K. When you will close this key, current will start flowing in the circuit. So let current I is flowing in the circuit. And what we have done, we have taken two similar type of closed loops. One in the connecting wires, that is here, and the second one in between the two plates of parallel plate capacitor. Now you can apply that Ampere's law for both the closed loops. You can apply that Ampere's law for this loop which is there in the connecting wires, and you can also apply that Ampere's law for that loop which is present in between the two plates of parallel plate capacitor. Now, according to Ampere's law, you can define the magnetic field for both the loops, that is for this loop C1 as well as for loop C2, right? But there is one important part here, that if you will close this key K, then the current will start flowing. And when the current will start flowing, then the charging of these two plates of this parallel plate capacitor, that charging process will start. And these two plates, they will take some time to get fully charged. Let's take an example. Suppose these two plates, they are taking a time of 50 seconds to get fully charged. It means during that time period of 50 seconds, at different times, the charge over the two plates, that is different. It means from 0 to 50 seconds, if you are taking any two times, let us say time T1 and T2, at those times the charge over the two plates is different, right? So after a particular duration, these two plates will get fully charged. Now if you will open this key, when these two plates will get fully charged, now if you will open this key, then the discharging of these two plates will start. And again during that process of discharging, again these plates will take some time to get fully discharged, and during that process of discharging, again at different times, the charge over the two plates will be different, right? So now we are going to apply that Ampere's law for for these two loops, that is for loop C1 and that is here in connecting wires, and for loop C2, which is there present between two plates of parallel plate capacitor. Now, if that Ampere's law holds, then according to Ampere's law, for loop C1, the closed line integral of magnetic field, if I am writing it as loop C1, then it will be equal to mu naught into I, right? Because I is the current enclosed by this closed loop. So, if you will see this particular law carefully, then you can see here that according to Ampere's law, there is magnetic field because of this current. So, there is magnetic field, and the reason you also know that reason is the current flowing in that those connecting wires. Now, we are taking our second part, we are taking our second loop, that is loop number C2. So, that loop is present in between these two plates, and between the two plates of parallel plate capacitor, there is no actual flow of electrons, means that conduction current, which is there because of the movement of electrons, since there is no electrons moving in between these two plates of parallel plate capacitor, there is no actual flow of electrons there. So, if you will apply that Ampere's law for your loop C2, which is there in between the two plates of parallel plate capacitor, then according to Ampere's law, this will be mu naught times the current enclosed. Now, you can see here, since there is no actual flow of electrons. So, if there is no actual flow of electrons, so there should not be any magnetic field between these two plates of parallel plate capacitor. That is according to the statement of Ampere's law. What I am saying here, you have two similar type of closed loops. One is in connecting wires and the other one is present between the two plates of parallel plate capacitor. The first one, which is there in the connecting wires, there you are getting a magnetic field, and you also know that magnetic field is because of the presence of the current, that conduction current in those connecting wires. So, Ampere's law holds good for loop C1. Now, we are taking loop number C2, and that loop is there between these two plates of parallel plate capacitor, and there is no actual flow of electrons there. So, if you will apply Ampere's law in its original form, then according to that, the closed line integral of magnetic field is mu naught times the current enclosed. Since no current is there, no actual flow of electrons is there, so you will write here, there is no magnetic field for loop C2. So, according to Ampere's law, this should be the case. But actually, if you will place a magnetometer box here, if you will place a magnetometer box in between the two plates of parallel plate capacitor, then that magnetometer box, that will show a deflection. So, practically, if you are placing, according to Ampere's law, there should not be any magnetic field. But actually, if you will place a magnetometer box there, magnetometer box means that will show the deflection, the presence of magnetic field. So, if you will place this magnetometer box here, then that magnetometer box, that will start giving deflections. So, if you are getting a deflection in that magnetometer box for this loop C2, it means actually there is magnetic field for loop C2. But according to Ampere's law, there should not be any magnetic field because there is no actual flow of electrons there. It means that deflection in the magnetometer box, which is indicating a magnetic field, the reason of that magnetic field is not just like the ordinary conduction current. There is some other reason of that deflection in magnetometer box. So, now we will try to understand that what is the reason of that deflection in the magnetometer box? What is the reason of that magnetic field in this magnetometer box or between the two plates of parallel plate capacitor, right? So, now that particular deflection in this magnetometer box, that deflection is because of changing electric field. So, If Ampere's law still holds, there must be a magnetic field generated by changing electric field between the plates. This induced magnetic field makes it look like there is a current called as displacement current. So let me explain this. You all know that for a parallel plate capacitor, electric field, you can write it as Q upon A epsilon naught, right? This E is equal to Q upon A epsilon naught. This is the electric field. It means this electric field is because of the charge over the two plates of parallel plate capacitor. Now take the case when the two plates of that parallel plate capacitor will get charge. So when you are closing the key, the charging of the two plates will start. But these two plates, they will take some time to get fully charged. And during that process of charging, if you are taking two different times, let you are taking time t1 and then you are taking time t2. Then at time t1, let q is the charge over the two plates. At time t2, the charge will be different. At different times, the charges over the two plates is also different. So, since this electric field that depends upon the charge present over the two plates, it means that electric field is different at different times. So, over these two plates of parallel plate capacitor, we are having a time varying electric field. Means we are having electric field which is different at different times, and there is a magnetic field in this magnetometer box. There is a deflection in this magnetometer box which is indicating a magnetic field. And if it is indicating a magnetic field, there should be certain reason for the production of that magnetic field. And the reason of that magnetic field, that seems to be this changing electric field. There is a time varying electric field. Why I am saying a time varying electric field? Because the charge over the two plates of this parallel plate capacitor, during the process of charging as well as during the process of discharging, charge is different. So electric field is different. So because of that time varying electric field, we have a magnetic field there. It means this deflection, the magnetometer box, this is given by that time varying electric field. So the reason of this magnetic field is a time varying, a changing electric field. And if you are having a magnetic field here, then you can say there is a current, because you can always correlate magnetic field with current. So the current which is there in this loop C2, the current which is there in between these two plates of parallel plate capacitor, that is not because of flow of electrons. That current is because of changing electric field. So this type of current, which is different as compared to ordinary conduction current, this type of current is known as displacement current. So I hope the meaning of displacement current is clear. Ordinary conduction current is because of the flow of electrons, whereas this displacement current, it is because of changing electric field. This current is known as current, or this current is, the name is displacement current is given because it is giving us a magnetic field. So because of this particular property of this time varying electric field, you are saying there is a current which is known as your displacement current. So the outcome of all this is that your Ampere's law, that can explain the magnetic field for loop C1. But this Ampere's law, it is not able to explain the Ampere's magnetic field for loop C2. It means there is some correction or some modification required in this Ampere's law. So that correction or that modification was given by Faraday, and that modified form of Ampere's law is known as Faraday Ampere's law, or you can say modified Ampere's law, right? So in the next slide, I will explain that modified Ampere's law. So I hope this particular point is clear. What you have done, you have taken a parallel plate capacitor, then you have taken two similar type of closed loops for loop C1 in conducting wires, loop C2 in between the two plates of parallel plate capacitor. For loop C1, you can apply that Ampere's law, and that Ampere's law will completely explain the magnetic field there. But when you will apply Ampere's law for loop C2, then this law, it is not able to explain that magnetic field there, because according to this Ampere's law, there should not be any magnetic field. But actually, when a magnetometer box is placed here, that is showing a deflection. And that deflection is indicating the presence of magnetic field. So, what is the reason of that magnetic field? The reason of that magnetic field, that seems to be a changing electric field. So, if you are getting a question based upon displacement current in your exam, for example, if you are getting a question, what is displacement current? Then your answer should be, displacement current is that type of current which is produced due to a time varying electric field. Right, and that time varying electric field is giving you a magnetic field. So whenever you have a magnetic field, you can always correlate it with current. So you can say that type of current is known as displacement current, which is giving you a magnetic field. Right, so this is your displacement current. Right, so the modification which was proposed in Ampere's law, this is the modification: the closed line integral of magnetic field is mu naught times the total current enclosed. But now in this total current, you are having two type of currents. One is the conduction current, which is because of the flow of electrons, because of the movement of charge carriers, you are getting this IC. And the second part is your displacement current. And what is the reason of displacement current? A time varying electric field. That is the reason of this displacement current. Right, so this is your conduction current and this is displacement current. And this displacement current, it is epsilon naught del phi e by del t. So what is this phi e? It is electric flux. Right, it is electric flux, that is electric field into area. So the modified Ampere's law is closed line integral of magnetic field is mu naught times IC, IC is a conduction current, plus epsilon naught d phi e by dt, right? So this is your modified Ampere's law, right? And one more notation for this displacement current is, it is epsilon naught d phi e by dt. You can write it in terms of displacement vector. So let me explain that. It is epsilon naught del phi e. Phi e is electric flux, which can be written as electric field into area upon del t. So this epsilon naught into e, that is known as displacement vector, denoted by capital D. So you can write it as A del d upon del t. So this is your displacement current in terms of displacement vector. What is capital D? It is your displacement vector, which is equal to epsilon naught into E, right? So why there is a need of modification in Ampere's law? Because that Ampere's law that can explain the presence of magnetic field for loop C1, which is there in connecting wires, but it cannot explain the reason of magnetic field in between the two plates of parallel plate capacitor. There is no actual flow of electrons, but there is a magnetic field. So the reason of that magnetic field, that is something else, and the reason is a time varying electric field. So it means that Ampere's law that needs some correction, that needs some modification. So that modified form is, closed line integral of magnetic field is mu naught times the total current enclosed. When I am saying total current, then it is this combination of conduction current and displacement current. So this is the concept of displacement current, and this is your modified Ampere's law. So whenever you have to apply Ampere's law, you have to apply this, right? You have to consider both the factors, that is conduction current as well as displacement current. Now what I am going to do here, I am going to write an expression for displacement current density. As you know, what is current density? Current density is basically current upon area. If you have conduction current, then you have conduction current density. If you have displacement current, then you have displacement current density. Now, how you are getting that? So, for this, You know, for a parallel plate capacitor, the electric field that can be written like this E is equal to Q upon A epsilon naught, that you know from your lower classes. Now, if you will differentiate this equation with respect to T, so just differentiate it with respect to T, you will get del E by del T is 1 upon A epsilon naught del Q by del T. And you know what is this? What is flow of charge? You know, flow of charge is your conduction current. So this is your IC, that is conduction current. So what you are getting now? You are getting your conduction current is simply A epsilon naught into del E by del T, right? And A epsilon naught del E by del T. So you can write this A here, that is E into A. So if you are writing E into A here, what you will get? What is electric field into area? It is electric flux. So you are getting, this is epsilon naught del phi E by del T. And you know what is this? This is your displacement current. It means that conduction current is exactly equal to displacement current. Or in other words, I can say the current which is there in connecting wires because of the movement of electrons, the magnitude of that current is just similar to the displacement current which is there due to time varying electric field. So IC is equal to ID. And if you want to write that displacement current density, so what will be displacement current density? That will be equal to, sorry, displacement current density represented by JD, and it will be equal to ID upon A. You have to write current upon area. You know this is current. Conduction displacement current is epsilon naught del phi E by del T, and phi E is E into A. So just transfer that A there. So after transferring, you are getting this epsilon naught del E by del T, or epsilon naught you can multiply with E, and you know what is epsilon naught into E. This is your displacement vector. So your displacement current density can be written as del D by del T. What is D there? D is the displacement vector. So this is the expression for displacement current density. So two important conclusions from this slide. The first one is that displacement current, which is there due to time varying electric field, that displacement current is exactly equal to the conduction current which is present due to moving charges. Means the current in the connecting wires because of moving electrons is exactly equal to the current which is there between the two plates of parallel plate capacitor due to time varying electric field. And the second conclusion is that your displacement current density, which is equal to displacement current upon area, that is given by del D upon del T, right? So this is your displacement current density. So this was your displacement current density del D by del T. Now before moving to next topic, I am giving you a numerical based upon the concept of displacement current. So I am giving you that particular question here. Suppose the electric field is equal to 10 raised to power 4 sine of 10 raised to power 6t. Suppose this is electric field, right? And you have to find the displacement current density here. So you know that displacement current density is del D by del T, and you also know D is epsilon naught into E, so you can write it as epsilon naught into E. So this will be epsilon naught del E by del T, right? So JD will be equal to epsilon naught in free space, you know it is 8.85 into 10 raised to power minus 12 coulomb square per newton per meter square. And del E by del T, you have to differentiate it. So it is epsilon naught, and this will be 10 raised to power 10 cos of 10 raised to power, sorry, cos of 10 raised to power 6t. Just substitute the value of epsilon naught. What is epsilon naught? You know it is 8.85 into 10 raised to power minus 12 and into 10 raised to power 10 into cos of 10 raised to power 60. Using this, you can find the displacement current density. So you have electric field. Electric field is given, and you have to find JD, which will be del D by del T. So D is epsilon naught into E. So that is epsilon naught del E by del T. Just differentiate E with respect to T, and you can find the value of JD. So in the next lecture, we are going to write those Maxwell equations. How those Maxwell equations, they are obtained from different laws of electrostatics and magnetostatics, that we will try to understand there. And what is the significance of those equations, that different Maxwell equations, what they are actually representing, that we will understand in our next lecture. So that's all for today. Thank you so much.